Welcome to Notes on Nature TV. I'm Sarah.
And I'm Jamie. And in this episode, we'll be celebrating International Women's Day with a look at some of the amazing work our female colleagues do across the RSPB.
And we'll let you know what you can do to help nature this week.
But first, we're going to take a look at some of the amazing wildlife photos and videos that you've been sending in. And you have been sending in hundreds. Thank you so much. The first one, I'm just going to get this up on the screen now. This is a jay in a bird bath. Now, Sarah, have you ever seen a jay in a bird bath?
No, I mean, I don't often get to see jays because they're quite shy creatures. So to see one in a bird bath is amazing.
And it also shows the value of putting out water for birds, because you never know what's going to turn up. And we've had the cold snap. Hopefully we've all moved out of that now. Probably still a little chillier up north in the UK. But birds need water all year round. They'll need it in the winter for drinking and bathing, and in the summer for the same, really, because it's hot and they need the water. So jays don't tend to hang around gardens an awful lot, do they?
No, I normally associate them with woodlands, but saying that, I have seen them in the centre of Brighton and in the centre of Norwich as well before. So it's well worth looking out for them in urban areas, particularly at this time of year when they're on the move a bit more.
And that presumably is because they're drawn in by specific types of tree, oak trees and things?
Yeah, I know jays particularly love acorns. So the one that I saw in Norwich was clearing the acorns out the gutter of a church.
Very good bit of public service there to unblock the gutters. Very handy. Okay. What's this next one that we've got here?
This is like a blackbird.
This is a blackbird which has an unusual talent. Let's have a listen. Now, that one was sent in by Bill Jones, who lives near a fire station, and the blackbird has picked up the sound of the fire engines. How amazing is that? Sarah, you know a little bit about birds and mimicking, don't you? Because we normally talk about starlings a lot and mimicry, but there are other birds that can do it, aren't there?
Yeah, starlings have an incredible range for mimicry, but actually song thrushes are the ones that quite often catch me out. I had a song thrush yesterday that sounded a bit like a reed warbler, and now it's far too early for reed warblers to be singing in the UK, but it really did make me look around and question myself, and then I realised that it was part of that three-note refrain that you'll often hear in song thrushes, and it had just picked it up and was singing it as part of its song.
And I think you mentioned when we were chatting before that you actually have heard one that does a curlew as well. Was that a song thrush?
Yeah, I'm fairly sure it was a song thrush. I couldn't work out what else it was, but it was calling the curlew call. And I was desperately looking around with my camera to try and find this amazing curlew. And it happened on several occasions in the same place. And in the end, I tracked it down with the rest of the bird song to work out that it must have been a three-note song thrush refrain.
Extraordinary. So there are all sorts of examples of mimicry going on there. Blackbird, starling, song thrush are three we've talked about. There are other birds that do it too. And we would love to hear from you as to what you've heard mimicking what other birds, other noises around your garden. So do send them into notesonnature@rspb.org.uk and we'll talk about them in future episodes. But that was a fantastic and very talented blackbird there. Now, this next one is a tree creeper. And we wouldn't expect to see tree creepers in gardens often, would we?
I mean, most people don't notice tree creepers. They're so secretive and so well camouflaged against that trunk of the tree anyway. But to see them in your back garden is something quite special.
And we think that this is during a particularly cold few weeks that we had recently. This one is in Juliet Fleming's garden. It climbs the trellis and even feeds on the fattened peanuts hanging there, which surprised me because this is a bird that's adapted to probe into the bark with its little thin beak for insects. And this one, look at this one, it's on the ground. What's going on there?
I've never seen a tree creeper on the ground. That is completely new to me and quite incredible. But you definitely do notice that in cold weather, you get more unusual species coming to garden feeders. In the last few years, goldcrests have been noticed far more on garden feeders than they have in the past. And it does seem to be the fat balls that attract a lot of these animals.
Fascinating. So do look out for tree creepers. They're very tiny, very mouse-like, and what you'll see is like a little tiny clockwork movement of a little brown or white bird going up a tree trunk, but they never go back down, do they?
Nope, they don't go back down. And actually, if they're disturbed, they'll quite often just flatten themselves against the tree trunk. So if it stops moving, it's probably a sign you're a little bit too close.
Yeah, so take a step back. And then the blackbird, okay, I'm still thinking about that blackbird from earlier. The tree creeper will then fly to the base of the next tree and start its journey back up that one. So yeah, they're lovely birds to watch. You can get close, but as Sara says, don't get too close. Now, chilly weather earlier on in the year forced a lot of wildlife into our gardens. And this is a particularly special one. What is this one?
This looks like an otter.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? An otter has come into this fairly small pond in James Brown's garden pond. So what it's looking for there, I can't imagine. Maybe he's got some fish in there. But wow, what a visitor to have you to your garden.
I'd be really curious to know whether the owner of that pond had broken the ice. And actually, it was the fact that that was the only unthawed water that had attracted the otter to it in the first place. And breaking that ice for wildlife is so important at this time of year, but it's also really important to do it slowly. So there is a method of putting a warm pan of water on top of the ice to help make sure that it melts naturally and doesn't do any damage to the wildlife living underneath it, like frogs and toads.
Thank you, very good tip. And of course, frogs and toads are out and about already, aren't they?
They are indeed. It's a very exciting time of year.
Right, lots to look out for. And thank you again for all your wonderful photos and videos. And as we said earlier, you can send things like this into notesonnature@rspb.org.uk.
International Women's Day is on the 8th of March, and here's a video about it from our colleague Katie.
Hi, I'm Katie, and for International Women's Day, I asked 5 women from a range of different roles across the RSPB about their work.
I'm Paula Baker, and I'm the site manager for RSPB Scotland Loch Lomond Nature Reserve. At Loch Lomond, much of the focus of what we do is on Greenland white-fronted geese. In the winter, they're on site and they're feeding and they're roosting, and the site's really important for them, as is the area around the site. But in the summer and spring, although they're not there anymore, a lot of the habitat management that we're doing is focusing on making it good for when they come back. So it feels like it's like a constant cycle of trying to improve things for the geese. And it's always particularly exciting when those geese reappear, because they're just so much of our work is focused on that. For me at the moment, the highlight is seeing projects come to fruition that have taken a long time to develop. I think ecology is a long process, and things don't happen really quickly, but also similarly, projects related to ecology or visitors can take a really long time to prepare, to pull everything together, to get all the expertise, to get the funding, to get the planning permission, and then finally to have the diggers on the ground actually creating what it is that you've spent so much time on. That really for me is what makes my job really exciting. I think one of the impacts that I see the most is actually impact on visitors. So the site didn't really have any visitor facilities when I first started, and we now have a small nature hub, we have a car park, we have trails, and for me it's always been really exciting seeing, you know, kids really enthused by seeing a frog in the pond or finding a butterfly, and that's really exciting.
Hi, my name's Nicole Kahn. I work for the RSPB and I'm a conservation advisor. So my role is quite variable. It depends what time of year it is, actually. So in the spring and summer, it can be pretty hectic. So typically I'll be out on sites giving face-to-face advice to landowners about what they can do for nature, specifically turtle doves. So that's the priority species that we're primarily focused on with our work down here in Kent, which is the area that I work with. So that can be, yeah, looking at sites, working out a kind of plan on how we can make habitat better for turtle doves. And then as part of that, we'll do a whole monitoring package as well. So we'll be out doing survey work, and we have a team of volunteers that help with that kind of stuff as well. And it's basically that face-to-face advice, building those relationships, that's the key thing for us. In the winter months, it can still be quite busy. So we'll be out and about looking for what we can do for plans for the spring, but typically I tend to try and get most of my desk work sort of planned for the winter, so that means I get more time out in the summer, basically. So for me, I think just seeing whole communities get involved and enthusiastic about the project, you know, it's great because, you know, some areas that we work with, we've got, you know, farmers actually delivering management on their land. And then in terms of kind of helping to monitor the progress, we have a whole host of volunteers from that local area that are involved. So actually we've got some sites where we've got, you know, quite sort of youngsters involved. So, you know, there's a girl that's 13 that helps one of the farmers to monitor the trail cameras, for example. And it's just great to see, you know, everybody kind of getting involved and feeling really passionate about that work. You know, some of the villages that we work with, you know, they're very proud of their turtle doves. You know, I work with one particular village where they would like their village sign to actually have a turtle dove on it at some point. And if you speak to them, they're like, yes, this, you know, we're the turtle dove village.
My name's Lottie Van Grieken and I'm the project manager for COP26 at the RSPB. So my role is centred around the United Nations International Climate Conference called COP26, which is due to be coming to Glasgow this November. I love the fact that I get to work with so many different people and teams across the RSPB and also externally. I get to meet loads and loads of different people and learn about the amazing jobs they can do in nature conservation. I also love that I work in teams with lots of really inspiring women and as part of an organisation that's led by really inspiring women. And a major highlight as well is the fact that I get to work on a crucial international conference. It's probably a one-off opportunity for me to work on this while it's in the UK. My role is really focused on highlighting nature's role in tackling climate change and the risks that nature is facing at the moment as a result of climate and biodiversity crisis. So my role has been quite varied. As a result of COVID, the COP26 conference was delayed by a year, which while it has created lots of challenges both for everyone in their lives, but also for nature and climate. It's also given the opportunity for more connection across the UK and internationally to work together and really create a global movement around tackling the nature and biodiversity crisis. We get to connect with people in all corners of the world through technology now in a way that we might not have had chance to do in the year, and really spread the awareness and the messaging around the urgency of climate and nature crisis, especially coming in a year when we need to see the renegotiation of global targets for nature and biodiversity, both at COP26, which is what I'm working on, but also at things like the Convention on Biological Diversity.
My name is Tobea Wilkes. I'm based in our Cardiff office, normally in the policy and advocacy team down in Wales. I'm a nature policy officer, and I'm currently leading on our work on green recovery. So at the moment, the highlight of my job is obviously as part of policy and advocacy team, it's always a highlight to see a lot of things that we've been advocating for being adapted by the government. So to see them start talking about ideas that we've put forward. And at the moment, Wales is in a really interesting position because we have elections in half a year's time. So we're kind of dealing with recovering from COVID, which is where our green recovery stuff comes in. But there's also a lot of change happening. So it's really interesting to see the new ideas emerge. And it's always a highlight to see when those new ideas reflect something that we've been pushing for a while. I normally work in the office, so I just work in the home office now. So basically everything's been moved onto Zoom and Teams, but the work has basically stayed the same. So as a policy and advocacy team, our job is basically to identify areas of law or policy, so like government promises or government recommendations, and to identify where those laws and policies could be changed to work better to protect nature. So I spend a lot of my day talking to other organizations or other experts or producing or reading reports, either policy reports or research reports. And then identifying key areas that could be turned into policy recommendations. And then we bring those to decision makers, so either the government, or in Wales, the Senate, which is the Welsh Parliament, whose job it is to hold the government to account. And we kind of present our policy recommendations based on our research and our arguments. And we talk to them to kind of get them to adapt it into their own line of work. So it's a very, it's a long process, but that is basically what we do on a day-to-day basis.
So I'm Jen Smart, and I'm the head of conservation science for Scotland and Northern Ireland. So, I mean, I've worked for the RSPB for 16 years, and I used to, for a long time, I was working in conservation science as a scientist rather than a manager. I really love waders. I did my PhD on redshanks, and I've been really fortunate that a lot of my research work at RSPB has been around waders like redshank and lapwings and blacktail godwits. So I really, really love waders and all of the issues that they face. So a lot of the time I've been, you know, working on the predators that are important in sort of reducing their breeding success, and then thinking about how, what sort of conservation solutions we can put in place to help them. So waders really, really get me out of bed in the morning when I'm thinking about my own science, really. I think probably when I was actually doing the science, the highlight for me was just knowing that the research work that I was doing was having a direct impact on the sort of conservation action and interventions that we might do for a species, and to then see, you know, how those things were impacting positively on species. Now that I'm more of a manager, I sort of have to live sort of vicariously through the work of my team, really. So I still get a buzz out of seeing the work that they're doing, you know, having the same sort of impacts that my own research used to have. But I think for me now, really, my highlight is really just getting to the end of every day and knowing that I've done absolutely everything I can to make sure that my team are doing, you know, happy and thriving and doing the science that the RSPB needs them to do, really.
Well, that was a fascinating look at some examples of actually what is a huge range of work that women do across the RSPB, wasn't it?
It really is. And it's so lovely to see the range of careers that people have in this organisation, particularly women in science. It's amazing to see women in those kind of roles.
And the RSPB has made significant progress against our target to have an improved gender balance at senior levels of the organisation. For example, we now have Becky Spate as our chief executive, and we have a 50-50 male-female split in our trustee board.
And we know there's still more we need to do. Equality, diversity and inclusion is so important to the organisation.
It really is. And actually, this year's theme for International Women's Day is challenge. And we do appreciate and encourage everyone who challenges us to go further and to do better.
Now, here are some ways that you can help nature this week.
You've probably noticed, but the birds around us are starting to nest. And as well as giving them somewhere they can actually build their homes, you can also provide some of the bedding materials that they need in which to lay their eggs and to bring up their young. Now, they'll be looking for natural materials, and this is the best thing to give them, really. So look out for mosses, dried grass, leaves, some small twigs perhaps, anything natural. Avoid things like human hair and dog hair or any other pet hair, because these can contain chemicals from where we've used shampoos or other chemicals, veterinary treatments, for example. Hair like that can also be slightly too long, can wrap around small birds and not be too good for them. So stick to natural materials. Another thing to bear in mind is, particularly when our summer migrant birds start coming back, house martins, for example, they'll need mud. So if we go through a dry spell in the coming months, remember, if you've got a garden or anywhere you can wet some soil, basically, you can leave out some muddy patches where birds can come down and get little beakfuls of mud. I've seen magpies doing that around our pond as well. So magpies, thrushes, blackbirds, and especially house martins will need mud. What else can people be doing this week?
So it's interesting you talk about mud, actually, Jamie, because for me, this is the time of year where people look to clean up their gardens. That spring is coming. We all want to get spring cleaning. But for nature, it's not necessarily the best thing. Sometimes the things that we think of as a bit messy or wild are exactly what nature needs at this time of year. So leaving some muddy patches, as you say, and especially those kind of muddy nests that you might see under the eaves of your building, those are really important. Birds will come back and use those again. Swift, swallows, house martins, they really need that space to be left alone. Keeping your hedges a bit unkempt and a bit untidy can be so important too. At this time of year, you're starting to get things like long-tailed tits nesting, and they might already be using those hedges. So leave them be, let them go a bit wild, and leave a little bit of longer grass as well, and nature will really appreciate it.
And there'll be so much more to look forward to as the birds start making their nests, flying back and forth with food for the young, and then hopefully you'll get to meet the chicks when they emerge from the nests in a few weeks and months' time. So we hope that you have enjoyed this episode of Notes on Nature TV. Please remember to like us wherever you're watching this. If you're on YouTube, you can follow us. If you are on Instagram, you can also subscribe to carry on seeing episodes as soon as they come out.
And let us know what you'd like to see in future videos in the comments. Thank you so much for watching.